Hello, this is Hot Indonesia, and welcome to those of you watching us in Washington, D.C. I'm Dalton Tanonaka in Jakarta, and here is this week's HI Hotlist. Scary skies after the latest plane crash. Is it safe to fly on Indonesian air carriers? New dawn. Will Joe Biden restore America's global image? We ask former U.S. Ambassador Curtis Chin. And tweet justice. Is banning the U.S. president or anyone from Twitter okay? Here are my co-hosts this week, Sandrina Malakiano, Deputy CEO of Polmark Indonesia, from her home in South Tangerang. And joining us again from her home in South Jakarta is Linda Ibrahim, writer and business consultant. Hot topic number one, scary skies. The search for answers continues in the crash of Sriwijaya Air Flight 182. The Boeing 737-500 went down minutes after takeoff Saturday from Jakarta with 62 people aboard. This was the third major accident in 6 years, the most recent one in October 2018 when a Lion Air jet was lost. Nearly 700 people have been killed in crashes in this country over the past decade, more than anywhere else in the world. Now, the Sriwijaya jet was a 26-year-old plane that the airline says was in, quote, good condition. The budget carrier has not had a major crash in its history. Linda, air safety in this country is always brought up after an incident. Is that fair?
It is fair. Because if you compare it to, like, other air accidents, just in the region alone, you know, we pale in comparison to neighboring Singapore, for example, world-class airline, with impeccable flight history. But the thing is, what a lot of people, including Indonesia, are sometimes sidetracked is to compare air accidents with just road accidents and thinking that air travel is the unsafest way to travel. That's very dangerous. That's a wrong statistic to compare. Air travel in the world and in Indonesia, statistic-wise, still safer than road travel. And you have to think that in Indonesia, with 17,000 islands, yes, only 500 inhabited, you cannot afford to just forego air travel. So that's what that's the perspective people have to keep in mind when we talk about air travel in Indonesia. Notwithstanding the fact that there is a problem with air safety here.
Okay, now the Lion Air crash, going back, was tied to aircraft problems. We know about that. No finding yet of what happened this past Saturday. They did find the black box. Sandrina, experts have said that the plane apparently hit the water intact because of the debris field. They could determine that. This at least showed that there was no, for now, in-flight explosion, which could possibly indicate human intent, which makes people speculate about other things, right?
You see, Dalton, the correct and wisest thing to do right now is actually to wait for a formal explanation or statement from KNKT.
That'll take a year or two.
Yeah, you know. Sure, but the National Transportation Safety Committee has all the rights to do so. So after they have completed all the necessary research and investigation, making personal conclusions or speculations about what caused the crash is so inappropriate and unwise.
Well,
so
I didn't say what caused the crash. I mean, so I just say that it looked like
I'd rather focus on the fact that according to data from the Aviation Safety Network, we have experienced about 104 aircraft accidents with more than 1,300 lives lost since 1945. So as you said, this place is Indonesia is the most dangerous place to fly in Asia. But what about Sriwijaya Air? Now, this airline was established in 2003. It currently serves 53 routes, most of which are domestic or local flights. They only serve very few international routes, amongst others to Penang, Malaysia, and to Dili in Timor-Leste. So Sriwijaya Air has never experienced any fatal accidents before. We know that there were only four non-fatal incidents recorded. The last two happened namely in 2017 when their Boeing 737 jetliner overshot the runway, and in June 2012. Also, another Boeing went out of the runway not long after it landed. So four non-fatal incidents in 17 years, that is not a bad track record at all, especially when compared to, for example, you mentioned Lion Air, that has experienced quite a number of very bad accidents.
Yeah, you know, I felt safe flying throughout the country in recent years. I believe standards have been raised in the past decade. But Linda, after a tragedy, as you touched on a little bit, maintenance and procedures must be given hard looks, right?
Yes, and we have to admit that there have been problems of such in Indonesia in recent years. I mean, we were banned flying. All of our airlines were banned flying to Europe until recent time. So I think the most interesting things that was raised when Ignatius Yonan was the Minister for Transportation was he at that time alluded that the fact that most of airlines proliferating in Indonesia now are budget airlines, they cut down on safety measures, on maintenance, and that...
Wait, Linda, is it fair to say they cut down on safety measures? I mean, they cut down on costs. Are you saying that resulted
in... That's what he said. That's what I'm saying. That's what Minister Yonan said. And actually, I even wrote in Jakarta Post saying, no, hold on for a second. They cut down costs, but do you have any proof saying that they cut down on safety? So here's the thing. The answer actually lies within the ministry. There's a Directorate General. The sole task is just for airworthiness of aircrafts and seaworthiness of ships. I'm sorry, and that's the Directorate General that the minister has to look into when they're looking at their standard procedures, because they're the ones that actually determine whether a vessel can fly or not. You know, that's what I'm trying to say. I mean, but the government has to look into itself first, looking at the ministry, looking at the track record of the people working in that particular director general, looking at the categories they pull.
Yeah, and they should be doing this the whole time, not just after an accident.
They have to do it now.
Because we live in the world's largest archipelago, we must fly to get places. What can you say, Sandrina, to consumers to feel a bit more safe or to feel more... less worrisome?
To consumers, I think there's a more important player here that needs to do a very important improvement. That is the government, as Linda just mentioned. Because regarding the regulation, namely on the age limit set for commercial aircrafts and the control mechanism implemented to closely supervise all operating airlines. We used to have a regulation issued by the Minister of Transportation in 2016, in which all aircraft used to transport passengers that operated in Indonesia must not be more than 35 years of age. But that regulation has been abolished and replaced by a new one last year. So with this new regulation, there is no age limit now set for commercial aircrafts to be allowed to fly, and the age limitation is made based on reference from the company that produces the aircrafts.
In answer to my own question, if a passenger or you out there feel uncomfortable flying, don't. I mean, you wait or you take a boat or whatever. I mean, you know, don't force yourself to fly if you don't feel like it. Okay. Hot Indo will continue shortly. New dawn. Will the incoming U.S. president restore respect? We ask former U.S. Ambassador Curtis Chin next.
Chen Mingan of VCT Net Viet in Hanoi.
I'm Thairat Thongya of Thailand's Thairat TV in Bangkok.
I'm Monica Samborat from the National Television of Cambodia in Phnom Penh.
I'm Raymond Goh of Malaysia's TV Tiga in Kuala Lumpur.
I'm Glenda Chong of Singapore's Channel News Asia.
I'm Sachin Tommy of the Indonesia Channel at the ASEAN Secretariat in Jakarta.
This is your weekly look into the dynamic Southeast Asia region.
ASEAN Today on the Indonesia Channel.
Welcome to Foodipedia. Every week in this program, I will introduce you to one of Indonesia's fabulous food items.
Yummy.
Beautiful. Now, I'm ready to cook. Let's go to the kitchen.
It's done. Let's meet to eat.
Foodipedia on the Indonesia channel.
I'm Caitlin Turner, and welcome to Yoga Bliss. Dropping your hands to the mat, just step it back.
And out and up to the sky.
Up through your fingertips. Reach your right hand back behind your head. Put your hands separate forward and then start.
Yoga Bliss, only on the Indonesia channel.
You're watching Hot Indonesia with Sandrina, Linda, and me. Here's hot topic number two, New Dawn. In just a few days, the 46th president of the United States will be sworn in. But so much has happened between Election Day and Inauguration Day that Joe Biden faces enormous challenges. He must determine responsibility for the violence in Washington last week. And supporters say he must work to undo the political damage done by his predecessor. Curtis Chin is an Asia fellow with the Milken Institute, a U.S. think tank. He's also a former U.S. ambassador to the Asian Development Bank and joins us from Alexandria, Virginia in the U.S. Ambassador, thank you for joining us. You know, Indonesians here were shocked and then maybe sardonic about the violent protests in D.C., not far from where you are actually right now. Is the world right to react so strongly to what happened?
You know, absolutely. If what you're saying, the reaction is shock and dismay, I think we see that very much here in the United States itself. You know, my hope is that, you know, once this inauguration is done, we can as a nation come together. And I was struck by even the theme of the president-elect, soon-to-be President Biden's inauguration, which was really about uniting America. So hopefully out of this riot, this disarray, indeed this nation can come together and move forward.
You know, Joe Biden seems to be purposely keeping quiet on what needs to happen to Donald Trump. Why?
Well, you know, that's certainly a question for Joe Biden. But if you listen to all that you hear from Washington, clearly this nation, the United States, remains divided. It's a time of both great apprehension, as we really have to hold people accountable for what happened earlier this week. But it's also a time for hope. And I think rightly, the president-elect, soon-to-be President Biden, is focused not just on the important issue of holding people accountable, but also, you know, what many Americans really are focused on, how do we get through this pandemic and rebuild and restart this economy? So it's a difficult balance for him. And I think that's why you might say there might be more science than some would like, or more silence than some would like.
Sandrina, question for Ambassador Chin.
Ambassador Chin, how would you position these 4 years of Trump's presidency in the development of democracy in the United States? Many criticize Trump's leadership as an era in which the U.S. has experienced a democratic decay marked by structural and substantial degradation of liberal democracy that the American people have always been so proud of. Do you agree?
Well, you know, there's a whole range of opinion out there. I think what I would agree with is that these 4 years have certainly been a real tremendous stress test for the United States version of democracy. You know, there's many forms of democracy. Look at Indonesia versus the United States. But I think what is most important is, do the institutions hold? And clearly, our institutions in the United States have been pressed. But I'm always Mr. Optimist. When I look at what has happened, I can also note that the judicial system held, that people spoke up, that people pushed back. And I think we'll come out of this, hopefully, with a base to build on.
Question for Ambassador Chin. Linda.
Yes, Ambassador Chin. I remember living through the whole hanging chat saga in 2000 election and thinking that was like the worst that could possibly happen in U.S. election. But, you know, the long legal battle and all that. But that ended well, peaceful transfer of power. But then arrived 2016 with the allegation of the Russia hacking, rigging the election. And then now Trump hasn't conceded. U.S. Capitol riot, and then Trump refused to even attend the inauguration. Do you see that this is a trend that it is going to be in the future with U.S. election, there is going to be less peaceful transfer of power?
You know, I don't think so. You know, none of us can really predict the future. I mean, no one, I think, predicted how bad it was this week. But I think what's important, again, as we think about the system, does the system hold? You know, of course, you know, again, it's a time of apprehension and hope. You know, people are still worried about what will happen the day of the inauguration, not just in our capital here, Washington, D.C., right near me, but also in our 50 state capitals. You know, will there be protests? You know, one thing I do cherish in America is that there is a right for people to protest and to speak up. But the law is you have to do it peacefully.
Yeah, and I think all of us in Indonesia as well have hopes because many people here admire and still admire the United States for the opportunities and the system. So going forward, also another thing I want to ask you, Ambassador, you wrote an opinion piece in The Hill, which is a publication there in Washington, saying that Biden's incoming cabinet will not be as diverse as it needs to be. He has just about every ethnicity represented except...
Ever since Bill Clinton, to his great credit, there's been an Asian American cabinet secretary for some 20 plus years. President-elect Biden made the decision to exclude an Asian American cabinet secretary. So clearly it's an unintended message to Asian Americans, whether you're an Indonesian American or Chinese American or Japanese American. But sadly, that unintended message is the Asian Americans don't matter when it comes to the highest level positions in the United States, the secretary's level.
Why do you think that happened, Curtis? Why do you think that happened? I mean, there's a big pool of people, I mean, including Andrew Yang.
Of course. I mean, there's a whole range of qualified Asian men and women, and many were talked about. Andrew Yang, there's also the Secretary of Transportation from California. But I think, sadly, the reality is that it is politics. They made a political decision. The president-elect made a political decision that Asian American votes don't matter so much. They won't push back. Because even if the 6 or 7% of American voters, let's say 2/3 of them voted for the Biden-Harris ticket, they probably primarily live in California, Washington, Oregon, maybe Hawaii, New York, where the Democrats, sadly, I might say, take those votes for granted. So my goal was, you know, not to detract from all the terrific appointments that President-elect Biden has made, including Asian Americans, like our U.S. trade rep, if she's confirmed, will be the first Chinese American woman in that job. But to point out at the highest levels of government, it's not just about symbolism or tokenism. I think our cabinet would benefit if it has at the table a diversity of views. It's actually been interesting to see the pushback on my opinion piece. Well, people will say, oh, what about Vice President-elect Harris? She's both a Black and Asian American. And I say, absolutely, that is a great glass ceiling barrier broken. But you're avoiding my point, which is that the President-elect made the decision to end 20 years of progress for Asian Americans in the United States.
Yeah, and
by
hopefully
having a cabinet secretary post, he chose not to have one there. And can you imagine if someone had said, well, you know, there's no Blacks or women in your cabinet, and if someone said, oh, but look at the vice president. So I think, you know, celebrating diversity, we also have to recognize that this has been a misstep by the president-elect.
And he probably realizes that, but I'm sure there are forces at work here that we don't know about. Anyway, inauguration day, January 20th in Washington, D.C. We are all hoping for the best. Curtis Chin, Asia Fellow with the Milken Institute, former U.S. Ambassador. Thank you very much for your time and thoughts from the U.S. More Hot Indo is ahead. Tweet Justice is banning anyone from social media justifiable.
watching IVA Playlist.
iPop on the Indonesia Channel. Channel.
You're watching Hot Indonesia from Jakarta. Here's hot topic number 3, tweet justice. As a consequence of the DC riots last week, Twitter banned Donald Trump permanently. Then Facebook and others followed, all saying the US president's posts were harmful. But critics say the ban itself is dangerous, a blocking of free speech. Even German Chancellor Angela Merkel called it problematic. Now, Trump, my friends, isn't the first to be banned from social media, and Twitter and Facebook are private platforms. I'm a free speech guy, of course, but if someone posts something that actually does harm to others, I'm okay with a ban. Linda, you agree?
Generally, I'm okay with curtailing hate speech, but in this Trump case, because his base is so big and now there's a danger of running all of them underground, you can actually see what they're spouting about now. You know what I'm saying? They even took off that conservative app Parler off Google. I would have kept Parler just to see what they're up to. You know what I mean?
Oh, you mean Parler, that conservative app.
They pronounce it Parler, not otherwise supposed to be Parler.
Okay, so but you're okay with banning someone who incites a riot, correct?
Generally, yes, but in the case of Trump, because he hasn't conceded to this day, it's going to be even more dangerous when he goes underground or through the private, you know, chat apps like WhatsApp and Telegram, whatever, and then you can't even see what they're up to. All this kind of a craziness they're spouting and planning. And
yeah, suddenly, but they knew what he was doing and they did nothing. So it's not about the app. It's not about being private or public. I mean, it's his tweets. So
I know. No, I get that. And I agree banning him from Twitter. I wasn't talking about. I'm talking about running him completely underground.
Oh, I'm sure he'll find ways to get his points across. Now, Sanjita, you remember we had objections raised here in Indonesia when the government temporarily blocked social media access during protests. But that's the government doing it, which is different than this case, I believe, right?
Acts taken by social media platforms and intervention by the government are two different things. Social media platforms should be non-political and non-partisan, whereby government intervention always comes in a package that contains political and partisanship threats. The relationship between social media platforms and their users is flexible, while the relation between a government and its people is more rigid, binded by strict laws and regulations controlled by authorities and power. Now, a government intervention is more dangerous and problematic.
Okay, and that's not the issue here. That's not the issue. We don't want to debate the government. But are you okay with the ban?
In Trump's case, yes, because I mean, in walking this life, we have to always maintain and keep the balance between our responsibilities and our rights.
Yeah, it's the old axiom, you can't yell fire in a crowded theater because that causes potential harm to others. So, okay, we all agree that in this case, the ban on social media is okay with caveats. I think we all agree on that. Okay. Feedback time now. No posted this comment on the YouTube page of our partner TV1. As long as the coronavirus vaccine has been approved by the government, I am willing to get the shot. Well, me too, no? And Amy in Hawaii posted this on Facebook after our segment on tourism goals. Makes me want to be adventurous and visit Indonesia. Well, when travel resumes, Amy, come on down. I'll show you around. Here's how to contact us with your feedback. Email at hotindo@theindonesiachannel.com or comment through our Hot Indonesia or Indonesia Channel Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube pages. Final words, Ms. Sandrina.
January 20th, America will once again celebrate their democracy with the inauguration of Joe Biden and Kamala Harris as the new president and vice president. For a global citizen like me, this is not just another usual event or inauguration. What makes it so special is the presence of Kamala Harris. The fact that Kamala is vice president-elect is very important. This is a progress in the American democracy. She is the first woman to be elected vice president in the U.S. Aside from that, Kamala's victory underlines the fact that America is indeed a country of possibilities. And I believe democracy should always be a fertile ground for anyone to harvest chances and build a good life, not only in America, but worldwide, including in Indonesia. So let's take good care of our democracy, keep it healthy and strong, so that Indonesia can also be a land of possibilities and opportunities for everyone, with no exceptions.
Final words, Linda.
Along with Sandrina, actually, you know, as a woman, an Asian woman, I'm very excited that a triple minority Kamala Harris is going to be sworn in as the VP of the U.S. comes January 20th. However, learning from the past euphoria, even with Obama, you know, there's the optic and then there is the reality. I am holding hopes that the swearing in of Kamala Harris would open doors to women and minorities in the U.S. But I don't know yet if that would translate to a good trade deals with Indonesia, with Joe Biden, for example. I mean, there's a lot of uncertainty. We're in recession in Indonesia, and the economy is not great all around the world, including in the U.S. It's going to be very impactful what trade policies coming from the U.S. with this new administration. When I find out about that, and that's what when I think I'm going to decide if I'm going to see this as a new dawn or not. Man, yeah, but that's just realistically from me.
My final words now. You know, Joe Biden isn't a perfect person, and he won't solve all of his country's problems anytime soon. But what he will do, I believe, is make the interactions of his government with everyone more civil and kinder. You know, Americans like me are tired of the egos and fighting that affect many around the world, including here in Indonesia. I wish him and the first Asian American, Kamala Harris, vice president, well, and look forward to a positive start. And that is Hot Indonesia for this week. For Sandrina Malakiano and Linda Ibrahim, I'm Dalton Tanonaka. Thank you very much for watching and see you next time.